And this person is a person of David Ibokwe. He's a founder and CEO of Soundhala, a music technology company using AI to provide funding for artists up to $5 million. He has been providing music professional. He has been producing music professionally for over a decade, releasing over 5 albums while also working in the financial and technology sector in a growth capacity. Some of the companies he has worked with are Wells Fargo, Switch Media, and Transamerica. Soundhala has given over $65,000 in funding to independent emerging artists this year alone. So ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together as Mr. David Ibokwe dances onto the stage. Don't fall
don't
our leave. Hand.
Wake up. Kalaya money.
Kalaya money.
Wake up. Kalaya money.
Kalaya money.
Wake up.
All right, thank you very much. So our next panel member is Ms. Jade Osiberu, who started her journey as a filmmaker when she created Indani TV, a first-of-its-kind online content marketing platform, whilst working in communication and branding at one of Nigeria's leading banks. Ms. Osiberu went on to write, produce, and direct Isoken in 2017, which was the highest-grossing film. Isoken premiered in 15 cinemas across the UK and went on to win the Public Audience Award at the Nollywood Week in Paris Festival, got the Best Film and Best Director at the 2018 African Magic Viewer's Choice Award as Best Nigerian Film and Best Costume Design at the 2018 African Movie Academy Awards, Diversity Excellence Award at the MIPCOM and Best International Feature at Bronze Lens Film Festival. In 2019, her second production, Sugar Rush, was the highest grossing Nollywood film. It was released in 2019. She went on to produce Tunde Kelani's multiple award-winning biopics, Anyinla. In 2022, she produced Brotherhood, Nigeria's most talked about action movie, and went on to become the highest grossing film of 2022. Jade also wrote, directed, and produced Gangs of Lagos, which has been acquired by Amazon as the streamer's first original film from Africa. Please put your hands together for Ms. Jade Osiberu. Next up is Ebose Augustine Osega, who is the executive director of Anchor Insurance, but he's unavoidably absent and will be represented by Mr. Adebisi Ikumola, the executive director technical at Anchor Insurance Company Limited. Please put your hands together for him as he joins us on stage. Next up joining us on stage is the legendary Olisa Adibua, who is one of the kingmakers in the music industry right here in Nigeria. Please put your hands together for Mr. Olisa Adibua, one of the oldest cats in the building today. Please put your hands together. Don't stop until he's firmly seated. And the final panel member for today on this particular session is Dapo. And Dapo works with YouTube as a music executive. He has a wealth of experience in several different facets of the industry. Initially, he was signed to Chocolate City and Loopy Music as a producer and engineer. He served as an A&R before going on to become the head of music operations at Chocolate City Warner. Making his way through the industry, Dapo has sought to develop and showcase African talent on the global stage. Now the strategic partner manager of artists and labels SSA at YouTube, he's using his vast experience and position to spotlight African artists and provide a platform for budding creatives. Please put your hands together for Dapo as he joins up on stage. Now the final piece of the puzzle is our moderator for this section, and that is my very good friend Mosumola Nicole Akinwamide. Please put your hands together for her. I'll limit that today. I said it's my very good friend. For people who come and say that your friend, come give me a favor. I know Sabia. Now here the meet her first. Welcome. Thank you very much for joining us.
Hello everyone. What's going on? Hello everyone. I know it's a rainy day, but come on, we can do better. Hello everybody. So we'll get the best out of this session if we, you know, bring in a bit of energy, you know, if we're present and all of that. So let's try this one more time. Hello everybody. Yay, there you go. Hi everyone. Thank you so much to our esteemed panelists for being here. I'm so excited to begin this conversation with you. But again, women supporting women. So I'm going to start with the only female and the only woman on the panel. I mean, they were reading your bio and I was just like, this woman has done too much. Okay, so I'm just going to start with, everybody here, you have, if I call maybe like a category that you represent, please just show your hand. Artist, if you're an artist, music producer, songwriter, you're an actor, you can sing, but you can also act. You can raise your hand again. So, I mean, you want to listen in here because you never know, right? So the first question that I have for you is, a lot of people have asked, and the question is, how do you decide on music soundtrack or song selection for your movies? Do you just hire a music producer or music director, or do you personally shop around, maybe online, any other platform? How do you select songs for your movies?
Hi, lovely to meet all of you, and hi to the panelists as well. So when it comes to music in film, there are a few ways to go about it. There's original music which you make for the film, and we've historically worked with music producers or composers to sort of make music for the film. There's also songs that you license. So usually we would pick a song that we think fits the scene that you're essentially trying to produce music for. So for instance, with Brotherhood, at the end, we used Ashake's song, Ashake and Fireboy's song, Brain Freeze. Brain Freeze, what's that song?
Ashake's song.
Never See Me Coming, because we felt like it perfectly fits the end of the film. The criminal sort of got away and he was escaping, and so you never see. And it was such a perfect fit for that scene. People literally were dancing out of the cinemas.
Right.
And so typically, because historically we have got into trouble where you try to license a song, you contact the musician, the artist who's singing on the song, they tell you, okay, pay this fee. And then the rights owner, who's not the musician, comes after us. So now we work with a lawyer, Foza, who is experienced in the industry, and she sort of finds the real rights owners and makes sure we're licensing with the right party. So that's how we go about it for film.
Oh, so you don't personally like say, oh, I like this music, I like this music on a particular movie that I'm producing?
No, we do that, but okay. I'm saying to acquire the rights, we then work with a lawyer to properly acquire the rights.
Okay.
So if we would pick the song, and then instead of reaching out to the musician directly, because we know that might not be the person who owns the rights, we would then call a lawyer to help us acquire the rights properly from the rights.
So, but if you have an original song written for a movie, right, so how does that work?
That's a different path altogether. Okay. So typically we would then contact a musician, a producer, sign a contract with them. So for instance, with Gangs of Lagos, Chike sang a song in the film, which we three parties actually worked on. So there was the producer, there was the songwriter, and there was Chike who was performing it. Mm-hmm. So we worked with all three of them essentially to make the song.
Okay, fantastic. My next question is to the funding company. So people are asking, we have a lot of young cats. We all recently just found out that there's such a thing as a new cat and a young cat and an old cat, yes, everybody? So the new cats are asking questions like, of course, when we're talking money, everybody, you know, is going through it, especially with the economy. People are thinking, how do I fund a project that I have? How do I access this fund? What are the processes to accessing this fund? What are the credentials, requirements, and all of those things? So as the money guy, please show us the way. Where do we find this bag? Where do we secure the bag?
All right, so what SoundHala actually does is, if you go on our platform, uses AI, whatever artist, just can go right now and put your name and it will pull your numbers from major DSPs and automatically it's going to offer you funding based on the numbers you have, right? So you can do it for any artist. If the artist is too big, like an Ashake, Tems, it will not show you the numbers. We hide those numbers. But any other artist that can get below $2 million, you can see it on the platform. This year alone, we're giving out $65,000. However, there's a requirement, just like anyone giving money.
you have to have at least $100 for the last 6 months from your streaming revenue. Now, you might be asking, how can I get that $100? It's very simple, right? Most people think you need money to actually make that money. You actually don't. I call something called the 100 strategy. Get 100 people that love your product. I do it in startups. I get 100 people that love your product. Now get those people to post on their stories. Most people have 100 people already watching their stories. Now that's what, it's a 10,000 people reach. If you use the Pareto principle, 20% of those people convert to fans. 2,000 people love your song. Right now, if they stream that music 10 times, you release 2 songs in a month, that's 40,000 streams on 2 songs. Multiply it on YouTube payout, Spotify payout, or Apple Music payout. That's about $120 and about $260. That's already over the $100, and you never spent a dime. We use this same strategy I just gave you right now to pull 17,000 people to download our music discovery platform in 2 weeks. So it works.
So, sorry, do you guys understand what he said? No. So do you guys understand what you want him to say it again? He's here, so we can as well have him say it again. Maybe in a slower, more simpler way.
All right. I'll
so
take
how
it
do slow. We go to the website, we click on the website, the website says, hello, you're welcome. Then when the website welcomes us, what's the first thing that we do? Do you get what I mean?
Yeah, like, I feel just you, I feel walk you, us I feel through, you. Okay, yes. Fine, okay. So if you go on our platform, click Get Funding, and then it opens the platform for you. Just put any artist name, put your email, it signs you up. In like 5 minutes, it calculates your data from major DSPs. If you don't have up to $100 a month, it's going to reject you and tell you, hey, when you do, we will send you an email and tell you, hey, you now qualify, right? So if you don't, if you do have money, it will show you there. You set the terms. You have a place in the application to set the terms, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year contract. We start off your back catalog. So what songs do you have in the future? What songs do you want to give, right? You can set everything the way you want it. Our AI only works on giving you funding based on what you're setting. It's just predicting it. And you get up to 8 times your annual streaming revenue.
So do you have to be popular for this? So again, we're talking to the new cats. Let's say I just started and I just put a song up and I just have 200 views, all of those things. What are the metrics and how is that quantifiable to the explanation that you just made?
So that's $100 a month, right? That's a requirement. If you don't have that for 6 months, we can't give you nothing, like normally, right? But I'm giving the strategy that you can literally use without spending any money to get people to your stuff, right? To your YouTube, Apple Music, or whatever you're trying to push. But once you hit those numbers, automatically, the funding, we're looking for you. That's what we do.
So you get funding by popularity, engagement, views?
Actually, we don't care how popular you are. We only care about the numbers. So if you stream from these numbers, right? Spotify might not take your stuff down, but when we see the report, you might see 10 million streams there, but we see the payouts, it's for 1 million. We're giving you the money on 1 million, no matter how big you are. That's where we've had a lot of issues with artists, because when we see their numbers or the data pulls on their numbers, we're seeing 13 million streams, but then you see the report and it's not tallying up. If it's not tallying up, we know there's fraud. Sometimes the report will tell you two fraud, right? This person, the AI will tell you that this is fraud, right? If it's not, sometimes it will just, you know, give you the minimum funding and then you might not like it.
Okay, so that that's settling in. So outside of like, because that's tech I see, but is there any other like traditional method or medium to which we can access fund outside of just maybe doing our online?
So I like to, like when I talk to the artist, we have an artist click, SoundHall Artist Click, which we manage. And when I talk to them, I'm like, yo, you have to see yourself as a startup. And there's something called F&F round, like family and friends round. Right, I don't care what you're doing. Like, if you cannot raise money from your family and friends, your product is not good enough. They don't believe in you. Because the people that know you won't believe in you. Is it we that don't know you that will believe in you? Right? So you gotta think about like that first. So think, see yourself as a startup first. And the first thing is to get the initial traction. You don't need money to get 100 people to like your song. If you do, it means you don't know your audience. You don't know who you're targeting. And once you find your who, if I hire 100 people that love my product, they already told me that this is a demographic. So their friends are people that will like my stuff, right? So when they post it, that's exactly how we took the SoundHollar platform to 17,000 users in 2 weeks. Literally, it's because the people that were posting it were Unilag college students and their friends were seeing it and they were jumping on the platform. We didn't pay any blog, but if you Google SoundHollar Music Discovery, you'll see them carrying, oh, we're paying this, we're paying that. We didn't pay anybody for that. They were telling their people and telling their people, and that's how you get people to talk about it. But if nobody's talking about you, maybe you don't have anything to talk about.
Wow, okay. So are there any background checks of because I know you said go online, click on get funding and all of that. Is there any kind of requirements, criteria, background checks that you guys have to do before we can do
this? Yeah, this money is disbursed in a week, first of all. It's not a long process.
Oh, wow.
It's in a week. In 3 days, we give you an offer. That same week, you collect your money. The people that have collected money is exactly that fast. Right. The requirement is still, when we give you the offer, you accept the contract, right? We are partners, because we have partners in the US, we do a face-to-face call, right? To make sure this artist is actually the one that, you know, so because people are funny, right? They can have access to your report and collect money on your behalf, and then you are on Twitter.
I mean, I can just go and get like a face mold that look like Ashake and the likes and stuff.
Okay. But it's just like we go through your stuff, we'll have a face-to-face call with you if we feel that there's something sketchy, right?
Okay. Fantastic. So let's go to, so now we've collected money. First point is that Jade has told us how, you know, she picks a music and the whole selection process. The money guy has told us how we can get money. The next person I'm going to ask a question is our representative in the insurance company. Now, how do we insure? Because it's one thing for us to get the gig from Miss Jade, another thing for us to get the funding, another thing for us to insure. So my question to you is, can you speak on the importance and the general benefit of having insurance and why this can help an artist scale their talent without emergency distress or unforeseen liabilities?
Yeah, thank you so much. For me, this event represents various shades of emotion. I'm super excited this morning in the midst of great minds, creative industries with a lot of potentials. While I was coming in, I was just discussing with some of my colleagues to get an overview of some of the potentials inherent within the entertainment industry. For me, personally, the creative industry has a lot of potentials in terms of export globally. And come to think of it, if you look at some of the potentials, maybe in the film industry, music industry, for me personally, I'm so addicted to the home videos. This Nollywood industry, I must confess. I must confess. So I just try to scribble down some.
Oh, that's fine.
Some things, yeah? You permit me.
Okay.
According to PwC, the entertainment industry has potential of becoming one of the country's export with projected annual consumer growth rate of 8.8% in 2021. Nigerian film industry contributed about 2.3%, about $660 million to the GDP. The growth in the entertainment sector had been phenomenal and strengthened as its inclusion in the competitive nation rebased GDP in 2014. That's by the statistics. The creative sector contributes about 1.35 trillion naira to the country GDP.
Where's this money, please?
You should ask them.
No, the money guy. Let's ask them. It's not you.
So the role of the Nigerian entertainment industry has increasingly become important in generating needed employment to a large degree, limiting the jackpot syndrome.
Wow. Okay.
It's a platform for poverty alleviation. The Nigerian Film and Video Censors Board estimates that Nollywood employs about 1 million people in Nigeria. Yeah.
1 million people.
Yeah.
Wow.
Then the Nigerian film and music industry continues to grow at a rapid pace. What are the available opportunities? One, use of technology to enhance performance quality, training and development, equipment leasing, sourcing for financing, then structuring of business plans. What are the possible challenges? It's not actually for speech making, but I need to give an overview of piracy.
Mm-hmm.
Lack of proper legal framework, skill sets, distribution network. Finally, stakeholders need to be fan centric.
Mm.
You need to look at your fan as your constituency.
Right.
And you need to do something about that.
Right.
Then coming to the insurance sector and the possible benefit of insurance. Number one, insurance is a vehicle for social policy in times of a turning catastrophe. For example, if somebody suffers an injury, for example, or your vehicle suffers an accident, the insurance company has a platform through which compensation could be paid to you.
Mm-hmm.
Then another area which insurance could be of benefit is one, infrastructural developments. For example, enabling innovations. We have a lot of content writers, content developers all around the place. So insurance is a platform through which we could develop these potentials. And this body, we have almost 60%, I stand to be corrected, of our population, youthful population, 60%. So if that is the case, then we need to do something about that in developing, providing a platform through which those potential could be harnessed, properly harnessed, and developed.
So do you think that, sorry to butt inside, but do you think that a general, maybe an artist, a producer, record label, and the likes of people that are represented here, do you think that, first of all, they're aware that there's some kind of insurance that they're supposed to obtain for their own personal consumption or for their own business? Do you think that, I mean, because, sorry, let me just do a quick sample opinion. How many of you guys here have some kind of insurance for your business, your equipment, your talent, everything? Raise your hand. See, so what I'm trying to see is how everybody here who has some kind of talent, you know, creative talent, how can they leverage on the vehicle of insurance? How can they harness that, you know, all the opportunities that are in there, how can they harness it into their own personal growth and then, of course, to scale their personal business?
Yeah, thank you so much. As a stakeholder within the insurance industry, we normally create a platform through which we sensitize and create awareness amongst stakeholders within the entertainment industry for them to actually leverage on the benefits of insurance. For example, we have what we call the group personal accident insurance policy, which can be made available to members of the entertainment industry. Maybe they are going on a location, they have to move from one place to the other,
right,
and that provides 24 hours cover.
Right.
It covers them against death, permanent disability, temporary disability, and some minimum amount of medical expenses that may be incidental to the activities.
So as an artist now, what kind of insurance can I get?
As an artist?
Yes, so say I'm an artist.
Personal accident insurance is good for you.
Okay.
Then for your motor vehicles, moving from your house to the location, you have to provide a motor vehicle insurance for you.
Fantastic.
Then event centers like this, we have a, what we call a public liability policy to cover injury, bodily injury that may be suffered for people having access to these premises. It's also very, very vital.
Okay.
Then another area we can look at is the travel insurance, both local travel and international travel.
I have a question on that, but on a later time.
Okay.
So I'm going to come to that because I don't want to then jump into the next thing because I have an entire question about touring.
Yeah.
We have artists here who are now wanting to tour Europe, you know, this live
we'll be
Europe.
Ready to provide that.
Exactly. So we'll get into that, but I don't want to quickly jump into that because I want to ask Mr. Olise another question, if you don't mind. The legendary. Okay, so I have a question for you, Sam. My first question is, radio and television has played a crucial role in shaping how music is consumed and enjoyed. What do you think the impact of radio and TV has been on the music industry over the years, and how has it helped the music industry thus far?
Thank you very much. I want to say good morning to everybody, and also thank you for inviting me to be a part of this panel. It's an honor and a pleasure, and also for you guys to be here, taking the time out through a very rainy Thursday morning. I want to say a big shout out to my big brother, the legendary Laulu Akins is here.
Woo.
Please, can you give him a round of applause, please?
Round of applause, don't be snob people.
If you don't know who he is, get on your phone and Google him, okay?
Hello, sir. It's so good to see you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't want to explain to who he is. Just Google him. He's
my
a legend, and we love
goodness.
Him. Okay, yes, I've had the pleasure and honor of working in radio, in television, in events and everything. Over the years, no doubt, radio has been very powerful. TV has been very powerful as well. Obviously, radio came first. And when MTV came along, for those of you who were not old enough, I am old enough to have watched the very first video that was played on MTV. The song was called Video Killed the Radio Star. So they were thinking that TV was music, television was gonna be the death of radio. But the thing about radio is that radio has a way of being community-based. So something that stems from the grassroots and maintains its grassroots is very hard to kill. So over the years, they've coexisted, radio and television. Obviously, television is more powerful because it's working with different types of senses more than radio. Radio is just the oral sense. But television, of course, you have the visual, you have the oral and everything. Now, since the advent of technology, we've seen a serious shift with digital and social media. Mm-hmm. Anybody working in radio or TV globally who says that they don't recognize what has happened is just not being honest with themselves, okay? The impact or the power of radio and television is still there, and it will not go away, but it has to now compete with the digital and social media. And not just that, beyond, I'm not just talking about, you know, Instagram or Snapchat, but over the last 12 months, for instance, we've seen the power of TikTok, for instance. TikTok has blown songs up without the songs even being on radio.
Absolutely.
You know, and we've also seen what happened during the pandemic. All of us were locked down, locked at home, and in that pandemic period, between maybe, if you say January 2020 to like December 2021, we saw the amount of artists that came through in the Nigerian music scene.
Absolutely.
People like Omalay, people like Buju, people like Oxlade, people you never heard of.
Right.
So that was the power of the digital aspect. So as an artist now, moving forward, you need to be on all three. You need to be exploring all three.
Mm.
And technology has been so wonderful and so beautiful that you don't have to... you don't have to leave your house even to get to upload your music on digital social media. And then if for any reason you can't get your song played on radio, you can't get your video played on TV, you still have other options. And consumption of media changes with every generation. So with the millennials, we saw a certain, we noticed how the millennials were consuming their, now you have the Gen Zs, and coming after Gen Z, Gen Alpha.
Right.
Now, we call them screenagers because they consume everything now on the screen. The dynamics of sitting in your house, family around the TV now, most of these people don't own televisions, you know. A lot of people don't own TVs anymore, so they consume it on their handheld cells. So you need to, if you're trying to promote a movie, a song, your fashion store, whatever it is, you need to make sure, especially if you're targeting that particular, the newer, the younger demographic, you need to be not just on radio, not just on TV, but you need to spread and be on social and digital media. But I'm sure most of you already know that already.
Fantastic. A round of applause, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for that answer. My question is to Dakpo, the YouTube man. So all of you that have YouTube questions, this is the person to harass today. Okay, so my first question to you is, as I would imagine, is the question on the minds of everybody. What is YouTube looking for in a content or in music? And how can a new cat take advantage of this opportunity that YouTube provides?
First of all, good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me. Always excited to be doing this with Make Music and celebrating World Music Day every year. To answer your question, what kind of content and music is YouTube looking for? So YouTube is not particularly looking for music or I guess that's the way Ramba would say. But we're open to everything, right? We have all sorts of content on our platform, including music, including content creators, from skits to movies. I mean, there's old Nollywood movie. I just watched Isakawa from beginning to end. Like, it took me like 2 days. But I just watched it again, all on YouTube, right? There's a lot more coming up. Now we have so many different forms of content on YouTube, so you can do both. Long-form content, short-form content, you can do live streams, We've got like the community-based tab. We've got playlists. We've got YouTube Music where you can, you know, watch your videos and also just listen to the audio. So many different types of content. It's not, we're not limited to, we're looking for this certain type of content or that content. As long as it's respectful to everybody, we're good with it. So it's really, you know, bring the content in and sort of, it's up to you to take advantage of everything we have, right? We have some, I mean, of course, we'll go into this, you know, later in the panel and when we do the workshop, but there's a lot of opportunities for every type of content, every single type of content. So we're happy to have as much content as possible.
Yay. Okay, so my question is to Jaddy. And you talked about this earlier in the question that I'd asked, and then, of course, when you were summing that up. And the question really is, in one of your recent blockbuster movie, Gangs of Lagos, everybody, I say hello. This is the creator, producer of Gangs of... Why are you acting humble? She recently, obviously, released Gangs of Lagos, and I must say, I particularly really loved the movie. And you casted a recording artist, Chike. And I believe he was also part of the soundtrack because there's a part where I heard him sing and all of that. How can an artist position themselves for opportunities like this? And what were the contracting arrangements like? Because, again, we talked about this earlier. You have the young cats here who are thinking, how can I get into, you know, the movie industry? I have songs that are good. How can I, you know, tap into that opportunity and all of that? And I'm using Chike here as a case study because he was also an actor and then he was also a songwriter as well. And then, exactly. So I'd like to know how that, what that arrangement is, and just walk us through the process so that everybody else here understand what that looks like.
Okay, so with Chike in particular, Chike has actually been acting on TV. He's been on Africa Magic before.
Yes.
So that's kind of that was my introduction to him as an actor.
Okay.
But Zlatan is also in Gangs of Lagos, and Zlatan had never done any acting before. When we're looking for actors for films, the thing is, especially males, we have a lot of female actors, but for guys of a certain age range, we don't have many options. I'm typically looking outside of just film. I'm looking at comedy.
You have a population of guys here. So how many of you want to act? Raise your hand. Shoot your shot now. Why are you quit?
Oh, nice.
See, nice potential actors here.
Nice. in a film like Brotherhood, for instance, Basket Mouth is in there. So I'm typically looking outside of just film for actors. I'm looking, and typically I would be looking, because I think if you're a performer, you can be an actor. If you're any sort of performer, you can be an actor. It's whether or not you're interested or you can apply yourself. And so if I can see that this person is a confident performer and they would apply themselves to acting, I would believe that they can actually do it.
Right.
And so with Chike in particular, it was an easy sell because I had seen him before. We had actually worked on another film, which hasn't been released yet. And Chike is a fantastic actor. He's the boy is talented in many ways, to be honest. Like, he's crazy
Shout
talented.
Shout out to Chike.
Shout out to Chike,
this.
Yes. but then beyond acting, we also wanted him to do some music for the film, an original music, not music from his own catalog, because the character he was playing is an Igbo rapper. And so we didn't also want to saddle him with the responsibility of writing the music himself. So Blessing, who's actually here, I'm sure, helped us scout for a writer and a producer. And for me, it was first of all listening. So she just sent me a sample of their work. They're not famous writers or producers. It was just to listen to what they had done before. And that's how we kind of picked the team to work on the music together with. And yeah, so contracts were drawn up. Usually, so my own approach, and it's not the approach of everybody, sometimes some producers want to own the music that they create like that. So they will pay off the producer, pay off the writer, pay off the artist, and they own it completely. And so when they release a soundtrack, the producer of the film earns all the money from the soundtrack. But typically, the way I structure it is to say we pay for the production, but we essentially, that payment is to license it for the film. You own the rights to your music, and when it's published, you can continue to earn from your music. Because that's how I like to work, even as a creator myself.
Which is another opportunity for artists here who are listening, where you can make money as well.
Absolutely. Because when the film, so obviously when the film released, Chike and the producer and the writer then released the song. And that was actually
how,
like,
they made money.
Yeah, it made money and it was all their money that they made.
I mean, because I've seen that recently as well. I know you didn't produce Anikulapo, but I mean, that's the movie that was heavily, you know, you can see the original soundtrack that was done for that movie. And then afterwards, I think an album was released, or an EP.
So Anikulapo has done that. King of Thieves has also done that. Akimolayo. So they would release the soundtrack after the film has released, and then, you know.
the earnings from that. Sometimes they could be sharing revenue, so it might be a 50-50 between the producer and the owners of the music. It all depends on the arrangement. Yeah.
So essentially, that's another opportunity for artists to make money as well.
Absolutely.
So but how do you find them? Because I know you had mentioned that somebody had sent you someone and all that. Where do you look?
Different people look in different ways. I work with people who know the music industry well and can help me find talent. So talent is not fame. Like you were saying before, you don't have to be famous. It's like, do you have the work to show for it? And so those are the people that we will collaborate with. Different people find talent in different ways. But I would say if you're going to work in film, it'd be good to be interested in film. Because that for film, you're not just creating music as you like, or anything you like. You're creating for a particular piece of art and for emotions in the scenes. It's very, you know, it's so you can't just do whatever you like. Like, you have to actually love the medium as well and love the medium of film. So, yeah.
So do you search on social media? Say, for example, someone has a social media page and then they're just releasing different things as well. Because the reason I'm asking this is, people are here, they have a social media account. And people are just posting selfies.
Right.
See, and they can actually write and produce very good soundtrack, original soundtrack for your own consumption as well. So exactly how do you...
I would say absolutely. So whenever I'm recommended anybody, whether it's an actor, a musician or whatever, the first thing I actually go is Google you. Go to your Instagram, because from Google I can find out if you have a Spotify page, I can find out if you have... like. So I would search your entire digital sort of footprints and see what you have. And if there's nothing there, then there's nothing to go by.
There you go. Stop posting selfies. Post your work, people. Post your work. Okay, so the next...
selfies and your work.
But please post more of your work. We have not blown yet, okay? Let's post our work as much as possible. All right, the next question is David. What can an artist or a music professional do to position themselves to access these fundings, and what are the current potential opportunities that they can take advantage of? You know, you started the conversation earlier, so this essentially is just to bottle this up.
How to qualify for it, right?
Exactly.
Well, there's so many ways I can give that, but I think the very first thing I would say is most people don't know why they're doing it. You don't know why you're doing it, so there's a certain kind of passion that comes when you know your why. I mean, your why is your mission.
Absolutely.
So when the wall is in front of you, are you going to go through it? At that point in time, we know.
Yeah.
So at this point, you should probably ask yourself, why are you doing this? Is it for flex? Or do you really want this thing? Because that why now gives you now you know, okay, I this is why I want to do this. Now, the question is, you know, who do you want to do this for? Right? Who am I singing to? Who am I making this music for? Because, and this is very important, because once you understand why I'm doing something, who I'm doing it for, the how becomes easy. I'll find out how to make this thing happen.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but once I get the why, the who, and the how, you can't stop me. It's just time now. You're going to be successful. It's just time because you know who. I know who I'm speaking to. Make Music, this conference, knows who this conference is for. Right, so they target the people, and that's why people are here. Right, so you need to know who you're talking to. And for me, that who part again, it comes down to when I work insurance in America, there was something they made us do when we started working. They told us write 100 people in your circle, 100 people. And then we make calls to these people, not to talk on the phone, one-on-one. And we're trying to get them to sign up. And these 100 people are your family and friends. Most likely, they'll never say no. That's why they know. So already, they set you up for success because your family and friends will not say no to you when you're starting a new business.
Absolutely.
Exactly. So if you go to whatever money you're looking for right now for your career, if you actually write down 100 people in your circle, don't go ask them for money. Tell them, oh, I'm starting this business. There was a whole line they give us. I'm starting this business. This is what I'm doing. These are my numbers. This is what I'm doing. This is my Spotify page. This is how I'm growing. I need this amount to get to this level. You'll get the money you need to get to the level. But once again, I give you guys my strategy of 100. If you try it today, you will see a huge difference. Get 100 people that love your song to post your stuff. It's 10,000 people that have seen it. If 20% convert, that's 2,000. If they stream it 10 times, it's 20,000. Drop 2 singles a month, that's 40,000 streams. That's a minimum of $120 a month. You qualify for SoundHollar to give you funding. So it's not a funding issue. You have not just become the person that we can give funding to.
Fantastic. That's amazing. My next question is to our insurance representative. So what is your first name, sir? I'm so sorry to ask.
Ikuomola.
Ikuomola. Mr. Ikuoma, correct?
Ikuomola.
I'm Yoruba, so I was wondering why that was hard. Ikuomola, okay. Thank you for that. So the question that I have is, I mean, this is also a personal question as well.
Yeah.
So in the music industry, you find that artists work themselves to the ground. They're working hard, because we said the motto is work hard, work hard, work hard. So they're working hard, back to back, booking shows, performing here and there. I mean, recently we had, this is a very sad experience, but I mean, I just had to bring this to memory so that this can help people, you know, translate the information that we're talking about. A South African artist, Flex, had just slumped on the stage and died for whatever reason. You see, no, we're not going to why or whatever the reason is, but he just slumped and died on the stage, right? And then, so questions for me is, I'm thinking, what kind of insurance, you know, what's the entire process of walking through that entire ordeal? You know, what kind of insurance is required? Because I imagine that the show promoters, everybody's liable at some level, right? What kind of insurance goes into all of that? What kind of insurance should we set up to mitigate against issues like that?
Yeah, thank you so much. Firstly, insurance is about risk mitigation. We're aware that in the world, we're exposed to a lot of hazards. Even waking up is a hazard, is a risk. You waking up every day is a risk. Whether you believe it or not, that is the truth. That's a starking reality. So to come to the point you raised, we can arrange a personal accident insurance policy. Then if the artist is under a management, you should arrange a group personal accident. I'm sure it's not going to be only one artist. Maybe 1, 2, 3, up to 10.
Right.
A group personal accident, you know, policy to cover them against death, permanent disability, temporary disability, and some hospital or medical expenses that may be incidental to any activity being undertaken by that artist. Okay. So a personal accident insurance should be able to.
So do you think
that provides a 24 hours cover.
Right. So do you think that, so let's say that, God forbid, the artist who had died, is there some kind of, I don't know, compensation?
Obviously. When you are coming to the insurance company, you bring up information regarding the benefits, stipulated benefits under mm-hmm. the policy. Mm-hmm. Maybe say 500,000 or 1 million for mm-hmm. death, mm-hmm. for permanent disability. It depends on the types of benefit you are insuring.
Okay.
So that should be stated clearly in the policy. So insurance company will be able to identify with you in the event of such incidents.
So do you think that artists as well, performing artists, should also have, more importantly, like health insurance, personal health insurance as well?
Yes, obviously. Every stakeholders within the entertainment industry should have a personal accident insurance mm-hmm. to provide maximum benefit for the event of any eventuality, mm-hmm. which you cannot anticipate or envisage.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So everybody gets a health insurance. I don't think you have to be an artist or, you know, a performing artist of any kind to get an insurance. Just get insurance, do checkup, do your blood work, just basically know where you are at every point in time. If you know that you're not fit enough to perform, please don't climb the stage, and all of those interesting things, because we don't want
you
to.
You wanted to mention travel insurance. I don't know, maybe that's question.
No, that's a third question.
Oh, okay. Don't let me join question, the
gun. But thank you for bringing that up.
Okay.
I just wanted to mention, because it's important that, because insurance is important, whether you're an artist, but just a human being, especially where you live in Nigeria, you have to get some kind of insurance, because it's important. I guess insurance is what gives assurance to some degree, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. My next question is Mr. Olise.
Okay. Before you ask, can I ask my brother? Because I think we need mental health insurance in Nigeria more than any other, because with the kind of governments that we've had the last 10, 20 years.
Nigerians are traumatized.
You wake up one morning, they've removed something or added something or banned something.
I may not want to go into that area.
And when the prices go up, the prices never come down.
Yes.
So please, I'm giving you business idea
as,
now, my brother.
Blood pressure goes up.
Mental health insurance. Yeah. We need it in Nigeria.
As if our prices goes up, our mental health goes up. Yeah,
right? And it never comes down.
You never
go ahead, my dear. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you for that. You sort of have answered this question a bit in your earlier remark. I think essentially where I'm going with this is, so with platforms like YouTube, Spotify, SoundCloud, and the likes, they seem to have broken the monopoly in the radio and TV space. You know, at the time, you just have If your song is not on radio, if it's not on TV, you cannot blow. Who remembers? No, no, no. Am I alone here? If you don't, you go to radio station. I know they're new cats, Abi. You go to radio station with like CDs and stand at the entrance waiting for Mr. Olise to come out and say, what a time, right? And say, please, help me. And you know, and all of that.
Yeah.
And so you have the likes of, thankfully, technology has seemed to have broken that kind of that monopoly. I don't know if it's completely, but has broken that monopoly of, you know, artists having their song played and all of that. So I think essentially my question is, do you think that radio still holds some sense of relevance in today's space, you know, with YouTube, sound, all of those different platforms? Do you think that artists here should also still consider radio? Because like you said earlier, you said do everything, but is radio still as important?
Yes. The answer, yes. I'll explain why I'm saying yes. Not because I'm biased, because I work in radio, I work in TV, but I also own and work on digital and social media. I own my own digital platforms as well. Within radio and TV, over the years, it has become very segmentized. You know, if they told you there was a channel, when Ted Turner created CNN many years ago, people told him he was mad that nobody would watch news 24 hours. So over the years, you've had stations that are dealing with just weather, some are just fashion. You have a whole plethora of channels dealing with cooking, whatever your passion, whatever your interest is, no matter how esoteric and how narrow it is, you're going to find a station, especially with TV, that caters for your taste. And radio has gone that way as well, because there are stations now that deal with jazz or deal with old school, new school, stations that play rock music, stations that only play gospel music, absolutely, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So it has evolved as well. But outside radio, television has evolved as well. You have stations that are very segmentized, playing a kind of, you know, some stations play old school music. But the problem that we have, especially in this part of the world, is that not everybody can afford the data. That is the crucial part. You see, the data is the killer. We are all living in Lagos, people who are in Lagos, Port Harcourt, Abuja, big cities, Benin, Calabar, Owerri, wherever you are. And you have to look at the class of Nigerians. I create programs for TV and radio for multiple companies. One of the companies I work for is a network who are also involved in this exercise. They told me the average person spends 2,500 naira a month on data. Now, let's break that down. You might think that's ridiculous, because you are probably big ballers, you know, blowing money. But the average across Nigeria, 2,500 naira a month. Now, look at that person, that male, that female. What are they going to use that data for? When you list their priorities of what they're going to spend that money on, consuming radio, consuming TV, messing around on social or digital platforms, watching WizKid's next video on YouTube is not going to be the priority. The priority is that money has to make more money. You understand me now? So let's not fool ourselves about the impact of digital and social media. It's impactful, but it's not the be-all and end-all. The big spenders, and you can do the research, the big spenders, I'm talking about your banks, your telcos, your consumer goods manufacturers, they are still going to radio and terrestrial television because they know the average guy, the consumer, cannot afford to be on that digital space all day long. It's cheaper for them. They know that on radio, that person will hear our advert at some point in time. Right. On TV, they'll see it at some point in time.
Yeah.
So yes, digital and social media probably has about 20, it increases every year, about 20 to 25% share of the consumer brand budget. But if you, as an artist or as a creative, you should try and cover all plateaus, all platforms. Because if you can't afford to put your music on a particular platform, use the platform you can afford. But to say that the older media is dying, no. Okay. Because if you check the stats with all the PwC do their reports, I think a company called MediaReach does a yearly report as well. You find that they still. The big players are still spending money on radio, still spending money on terrestrial and digital platforms as well. They can't ignore it. Right. But the amount of people that are on digital compared to the population is very small.
Okay. Are we learning, though? Seems to be a very quiet... Are we learning? Yes? Very good. So we're going to move maybe slightly quicker because I still have loads and loads of questions for you. Thank you so much for that, Mr. Olisa. My question to you is, and it's very simple, and I think everybody else wants to know, how do we make money from YouTube? It's just as simple as that. yes, upload your content, put everything, because everybody says, oh, 1 million views. What does that mean? You know, 2 million views, everybody's like, congratulations. I'm wondering, congratulations, does that pay my rent? You know, so what does that mean for an artist who is here, and at what point do we make money from YouTube?
Oh, wow. So first of all, I would say that we're going to go into a bit more. We're going to dive a bit more, a bit deeper into this in the YouTube workshop, understanding YouTube workshop. That's later in the day. Okay. So I wouldn't go all the way into it, but just to give like a high level explanation of it is, I mean, it would function essentially like all the other streaming platforms. I mean, we have our differences, but ultimately, the streaming processes, you make content, music. Films, skits, whatever it is, you put it on the platform, and then when it gets to a certain point, you start to generate income. Now, depending on the platform, that income is different for streams. Now, for YouTube, for example, we have something called the YouTube Partner Program, and what that is that when you hit a certain metric on your YouTube channel, you start to earn money. So not everybody who posts on YouTube earns money, but everybody can. So, we've just reduced that metric now. Before it used to be, you needed to have 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 watch hours on your YouTube channel. And then you can join the program. And then from that point on, you start to generate income. And then YouTube sends you your income after, periodically. Now we've reduced that to 500 subscribers. And 3,000 watch hours. I mean, yeah, we just announced that this week, actually. And now you can even qualify from you doing YouTube Shorts, because we've added YouTube Shorts, right? So you can also qualify from using YouTube Shorts, and then you can also make money from YouTube Shorts. Yeah, you can. YouTube Shorts is monetizable
also
now.
Also, number of engagement and views on that as well.
Yes, okay. Yes. So, and the thing about YouTube Shorts is that. There's different people make money from shorts, from one short. So if me, for example, I'm not a musician, I use your music, you're a musician, I use it on my YouTube short, even though, say, I'm already in the YouTube Partner Program, the YPP, and I'm making money from that, but from that particular short, because I used your song, you're also going to make money from that. And whoever owns the rights to your music, however that is divvied up on your end, makes money from that.
As well.
So we're trying to spread it as much as possible.
Fantastic.
But there's certain metrics you need to hit, and of course, a bunch of other, million different ways that you can be. But like I said, we'd do a deep dive into that when we do the workshop. And I just quickly wanted to speak to what Olisa had said about traditional media versus digital media. And I think it's very important to understand that neither of those two types of medias can cannibalize each other. They sort of have to work hand in hand, which is, to his point. Radio, TV influences digital media. Like, we see a lot that people, you hear something on the radio. So let me say, the first point of difference is that with digital media, like a YouTube, for example, it's at your fingertips. You can always listen to it. With radio, you are, for the most part, at the mercy of what radio plays when they play it, right? So with YouTube, I can go on and want. If I want to see Asake's song today, now I go on and I listen to it. Now, that's one of the differences, right? But the thing is, they both influence each other. So you hear a song on radio, I'm in the car, I hear a song on the radio, I like it, and somebody, the OEP says, this is Ashake's new da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah.
I'm going to go on YouTube and look for it because I want to listen to it again. Well. But also, if I'm on YouTube, YouTube recommends videos, recommends other people's songs, recommends other content to watch.
Fantastic.
I see it, and I can, you know, that can influence what I'm doing on the radio, right? Even for the OAPs, because an OAP is also on YouTube, is on the other platforms and listening and streaming. You look at the charts, you know, you look at the YouTube chart and you say, oh, this person is, you know, high up on the charts. You can play that on the radio as well. So they work very much hand in hand. Okay. I just wanted to put that out there.
Fantastic. A round of applause, Abby. Thank you so much. So how many of you guys, I mean, I know we have artists here, so anybody wants to help me can quickly take my mic for 1 minute. How many of you guys can remember any song, any old Nollywood song? If you can remember and you can sing two lines, please come forward. Come, that's my guy. Come fast. You are leading us right to where we're going. Oh yeah, give us. Please make sure it's a Patient Ozoku movie.
Yeah, man. In this life, you report your soul.
What? You don't know this song? So at this point, Patient Ozoku is already beating the daughter-in-law. She's making sure that the daughter-in-law can sleep under the bed at this point. Now, this song is very nostalgic, and it leads me right to the next question. Daddy, obviously, you know this is your question. So, olden days. Old Nollywood, I guess, because I know there's a new Nollywood now. But old Nollywood, this was our stereotype. From the soundtrack, I already knew everything that's happening in the movie. Just one line like this, I know that, okay, this woman is about to poison this person. This, you know? All that sort of thing. But you have Nollywood now where, like, I mean, you have artists winning awards. At the recently concluded AMVCA, I know that a friend of mine, Kent, had won an award for soundtrack for Aniku Lakwa. And I thought, oh, wow, we win an award now for soundtrack. That's like, you know, we've come a long way. Can you please just walk us through the evolution of that and then how the industry has, you know, evolved into the industry, the new Nollywood that we have now?
I think that old Nollywood, for what it was at the time, I mean, you still remember. So evidently it was iconic, like it was memorable. There are some songs that I suspect that person should have won an award, actually, if we're still singing it so many years ago. But I think, as with any medium, style evolves, right? Even with Nigerian music, if you think back, like, style has evolved, even though sometimes there's a throwback to the style, right?
Yeah.
A lot of music now is influenced by Fela, for instance. But I would say probably the early 2000s is probably when things started to change, early, mid-2000s. So with filmmakers like Kunle Afolayan, for instance, sort of changing the game. There was a film called EJ, I think, back then as well.
And the judge that's changing the game as well.
Well, I didn't start in the early 2000s. I was in my early 20s. But the that evolution, I think, was also greatly inspired because we don't exist in a vacuum, right? I think new Nollywood is a weird sort of fusion of Nigerian culture and arts and storytelling and literature and all sorts of things and history. But it's inspired greatly by what we see in the West. It's inspired by Hollywood, it's inspired by Korean films, it's inspired by all sorts. And when we make films in genres, there are genre sort of styles and rules, and some of the older Nollywood sort of style of making that sort of, it doesn't really fit in. It would be jarring if you made a film now. If I made Gangs and it's like, your brother kill you,
trust people me, are we so will bad, watch whatever. It. Like,
it would be quite jarring, right? So it's, I think that where we are now is this weird sort of fusion, well, not weird, but it's a fusion of the things that inspire us, because a lot of filmmakers now, the things that we watched growing up was a lot of Hollywood. For instance, I love Martin Scorsese, and that's a big influence of mine. Tarantino is a big influence of mine. And so you would see some of that in my work. But if you also listen to the music from Gangs, you will hear the flutes of, like, the Igbo. Whenever you see Chike walking down the road, you hear the sounds. And that's influenced by old Nollywood, because that's where those sounds are. If you remember, almost every scene had this haunting, like, weird sort of, and we wanted to throw back to that era as well. So, yes, style is changing, but I wouldn't say it's a complete sort of abandonment of what happened
like
in the past.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or what happened in the past. And I'm also not going to crap all over what happened in the past either. As I said,
I enjoy listening.
People enjoy, like, there are people who love old Nollywood, and that's sort of what they grew up
on.
Thank you. My next question to you is, so can we like do something? Every time maybe a speaker has, you know, just finished sharing their thoughts, it'd be kind enough for us to maybe just clap. What do we think? Is that a good idea? Yeah, I think so too. David, my question is to you. So you talked about how and, you know, where we can get the money, come to your website, go click funding and the whole process. So let's say that I collected money from you people. And I've jackpot. Now, the jackpot can be in different ways. Act of God, person dies, you know, the person defaults. You know, maybe the person's not even popping as well. The person's not even creating the kind of content. There's increasing engagement, all of those sort of things. What is the recovery process like for you guys?
That's actually a good question, right? It's a good question because a lot of artists ask us that. The first thing you have to realize is that even if you die, we're collecting our money.
Oh, wow.
Right, so let's just put that out there first. No. Let me put that out there because I'm putting it at the extreme because I want you to understand that
Wow. You're
not the one giving us the money back.
Right.
YouTube, Spotify, like your distro, you guys already know now. So we collect we take your password. We take over that because of your back catalog. So we take over. So no matter what you do, and even you go on, you can sign with anybody, it doesn't matter, but that back catalog is coming to us, right? So we're protected. And we don't collect money from your publishing or anything. It's just your streaming. And don't forget, this is where AI comes in because we've predicted what we're going to make back. It's not based on we looked at you, your numbers on social media are good, so we decided to give you this money. No,
right.
It's based on what the AI is saying, that this person on YouTube is making this amount of streams, and now we saw the reports, and now it's tallying up, so we can predict that in 2-3 years, this guy is going to recoup this money back, whether he makes any new music or not. Which is why the qualification is that you must have $100, not for 1 month, 6 months. That means because we'll see how the, you know, when you release a track, you're up here, and then it starts to go down. We can see how it's moving up and down, and then we can actually give you funding.
Fantastic.
That actually, you know, matches.
So when do you stop collecting money, even when the person dies? I don't understand. Do you collect
money?
No,
okay, I'll just be the extreme. But once, and the amazing part of this is, I imagine you signed a 3-year deal with us. We give you funding, $10,000. Let's assume, imagine us, we give you $10,000 for 3 years, 3-year deal. Let's say you drop the track in that same month, and now you blow up. You are playing your song everywhere, and you recoup that money in the first month of your deal. Well, you signed a 3-year deal, so we should actually stay throughout for 3 years. We'll give you only, throughout the deal, you take 90% back. We give you 90% back. Even though you signed a 3-year deal with no income, we'll start giving you 90% after we recoup our money. We'll only take 10% for the 3 years. So we think ahead for the artist.
Fantastic. Are you guys... No? Yes, please.
Is it debt or is it an investment? What exactly is it?
Okay, so it's an investment. I mean, we could call it debt, but really, they will never have to pay back because it's just straight from the streaming platforms. So if we don't ever recoup, it's on us.
I see.
So there's no interest, you recoup, there's partnership to continue to take.
Well, we make money on the deal. So let's say I gave you $10,000, right? And if you play on our platform, you see that for 1 year, you probably have a 20% recoupment rate. That means if I give you $100, I get $120 back. So you make $20 on that. Right. As the time goes down 1-3 years, the recoupment rate goes up
as well.
So it's on the deal, right?
Are you guys getting this? Okay, they say she'll rewind again.
Which part? The recoupment.
The recoupment, okay. I mean.
So if we gave you $100, 20% recoupment rate at 1 year is $120. We'll take $20. But this is not for every artist. If you go on the platform, don't forget I told you, you set the terms. As you move around the slider, you will see the recoupment rate go up or down, right? So you set the one that works for you. We don't give you. We just tell you what AI says we can offer you. Then based on what you set, we just add it to your deal and take the money.
Is this clear now? Good? So people, this money matter is really causing a lot of agitation. People want money, but I don't think they're getting clarity on how they'll get this money. So I think the confusion maybe now is, I think in the dealing part, in terms of the deal, the recoupment and all of that, because then people are now panicking like, wait, you're going to have access to my password, yay, wait, you're going to, you know, that's always the concern I think that people are also experiencing as well. So maybe you want to walk us through that a little slower this time.
Okay, I'll slow down.
Thank you.
I'll really slow down this time. I think I talked too fast. Okay. So, first of all, like even the deal we just closed on one artist right now, you guys know United Masters, right?
Yeah.
They were in on the deal. So we moved their catalog, because we only do funding, we're not a distro. So we moved that person's catalog from another distro to UM, and they gave that artist...
So it was a distro?
They know all this.
They know. Okay. See, I'm trying to.
So like Tunko.
Pass is in progress. Like Tunko. Pass is in session.
Right. Good. So we moved from that artist. We moved the artist catalog to UM, and they added about 10 grand on top of it.
So
right.
This is clear,
so that's
okay?
Part of our partnership good. Circle, right? What to make it clear is when we take over, when we say we take over your distribution login and password, right? I mean, some other platforms have a way of us, you know, connecting back end and figuring it out. But you have to understand that that's just the back catalog. We cannot run away with it. You can still license your song to movies. Dance. You can do whatever. Mm-hmm. It's your stuff. The only thing we're saying is we got to feel protected that this, you already know, if we tell you to pay the money back, we hear a story. Right, mm-hmm. So we don't want to hear a story. Like, let's just collect the money, and everybody we've seen the numbers as it's adding up. And once it's done, you get your catalog back. Right, right. We have a bunch of partners that we're working with. Right, and you can always reach us. Like, we're not running anywhere. Right, but music technology.
Fantastic. So if we have, say, I have another deal with like Jaddy, I'm an artist now, and I have another deal with Jaddy. Is that a part where in the interface you guys make money from that deal, or this is just on streaming?
Absolutely not. Fantastic. Only streaming.
See, so you can make money in other areas. Fantastic. Before I ask, before I go to the next question, I imagine you guys have questions here. This seemed to be very insightful. Yes, yes, yes. So if you have questions, please go on YouTube. We're currently streaming live on YouTube. We're online on IG live session. Please drop your questions. The representative there will take the questions, and then we can ask the questions that are important to you. So please, you can do that now while we're here. Okay. So my next question is. What kind of insurance would you say that the music industry needs across all the offering sector? So recording artists, I'm talking record label, I'm talking producer, I'm talking show promoters, I'm talking everybody in the ecosystem. What kind of insurance do you think we like need very like very quickly, because now we're very short on time now. Like just very quickly, these are the things that you need, and then everybody go and get it. Or come
yeah,
and get it.
Thank you so much. Firstly, travel insurance, international travel insurance is very important. Most of artists have cost to travel outside the steward savage of this world mm-hmm. that we do, and all of those mm-hmm. Artists. And I'm sure I'm also praying for the budding potential at big names.
Amen.
They will hit it big.
Say amen. Now you don't want to hit it big.
So we need the international travel insurance offering. Good enough, we have a robust engagement with an international partner, MAFRE, is A-rated insurance solution provider. And we have several scope of geographic coverage on that.
So let me understand this, because I can break it down then. Because insurance doesn't seem to be like an easy conversation for a lot of people, especially Nigerians.
Yeah.
So when you say travel insurance.
Yeah.
So let's say that I travel to Germany now and I'm performing on stage, right? And say something happens. What does that cover? What does that cover me for? Do you get? Does it cover me for, God forbid, I have an injury? Does that cover if I suddenly fall sick?
Yeah.
Does that cover for like even my band members? You know, all that sort of thing. What does that look like?
Yeah. Before I get into that, let me say that we have three options there. One is for Europe, and that covers all Europe and Schengen countries.
Okay.
The second one is worldwide,
okay.
which excludes country of residence.
Okay.
Then the third option is a worldwide one, which covers worldwide, as the name implies, but excludes Australia, Canada, and USA. Then the type of coverage, for example, medical expenses and hospital expenses, the limit on that is $15,000. Then medical evacuation is also $15,000. Then emergency dental care, that one is $600. Then repatriation of mortal
all
remains.
All the money that sound high, like, all the money has gone. Don't we have like package for like low level?
I'm talking about the benefit now.
Okay.
Yeah, the benefit. Then repatriation of mortal remains. If somebody dies and you have to repatriate the mortal remains. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Okay.
So there's also a limit for that. Which is $2,000,
okay,
which is payable. Then if, for example, somebody falls sick and has to be hospitalized, expenses, and after treatment, he has to be repatriated back, maybe part of the families of the insured person has to be repatriated back to Nigeria, for example, you have a benefit of $2,000 dollar, which will be payable.
So
all of these product offerings is available. Our customer relation officer, we'll get in touch with you. And we have a product manager also, which is seated there, Moshokpe.
Mr. Moshokpe, can you please raise your hand? Please raise your hand so Miss that everybody Moshokpe. Can see you. So we can speak to her after this session. I think we'll have like 5-10 minutes break. I think maybe less, I don't know. But you can speak to her and then she'll guide us into all the different packages that he's just talking
then
about.
Then another variant of that is the local passenger welfare scheme for the local domestic route.
Okay.
And that covers, covers for deaths, permanent disability,
okay,
when you are onboarding the aircraft, when you onboard the aircraft, prior to onboarding, mm-hmm, and when you are disembarking finally.
Okay.
And it provides various benefits like a loss of luggage, luggage mishandling, medical expenses for 50,000 naira,
okay,
loss of luggage, 75,000 naira, then mishandling of your luggage is 25,000 naira. And the okay premium for an adult is 1,000 naira.
Okay, so
for children, it's 500 naira.
So I'm guessing we can get like this entire breakdown from Moshokpe.
Yes, obviously.
Okay. So basically, insurance is available. You can speak to Moshokpe after this session, and then she'll provide you all the information that we want. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, so my next question is, Mr. Olisa. So you talked about how radio is still as relevant and as important as every other platform, and everybody should try as much as possible to leverage all the platforms. Now, so what decides what music gets played on radio? One. Two, what kind of songs can make it to maybe airways? Because I've heard certain radio stations, for example, won't play certain songs, so you can enlighten us on that very quickly. And then how do you discover new talent, new song? See, there are like four questions in one, sir, but I know you helped me do justice very quickly. And then the radio stations, because they've also the conversations of radio stations also tasking artists to, you know, play their song. They ask you for some kind of rebates or some kind of, I don't know, financial, I'm not sure what they call it. Okay. You know, to play their song. So those are like four questions in one, but let me just remind you very quickly what the questions are. Who decides what music gets played on the show? One. Two, what kind of songs can make it to the airways? Two, how discover new talents without them standing and then harassing you by the staircase with their CD, you know, of maybe Flash or Guy Epos? Or the radio stations, do they still collect payola or, you know?
Okay, thanks. First one, radio stations vary according to formats. There's stations, the rock stations, there's R&B stations, there's old school stations, there's top 40 stations. This is, I'm talking about global formats now. There's easy listening stations. So in a Nigerian context, the format of the station, it might be a station that plays only Nigerian music and the presenters speak in either Nigerian languages or in Pidgin English. There might be a station that plays only old school music. There might be a station that plays the current hits, current music. So the format really determines the type of songs you hear on the station and the music policies there. And usually you have something called a PD, program director. He or she is in charge of the schedule. Obviously, the owners of the station, the MD or whoever, the board of directors, have decided that this is the kind of station they want, this is the kind of music they want. Mm-hmm. They don't want to play any music that says, you know, shayo, shayo, and bend down low, you know, all that, you know, the kind of music. So they might say, we don't want that kind of music. So they decide. The program director, along with the management of the station, decide on a regular basis, whether it's weekly, bi-weekly, or monthly, what kind of music gets on that platform, on that radio station.
Okay.
Second question was to do with the format.
The second question is what kind of songs. I think you kind of talked about it as
the kind of songs vary. I mean, Nigerian music, there's some stations that are Nigerian music only policy. There's stations that, you have to abide by the NBC, who's the regulator, the rules. You have to have a certain amount of local content, certain percentage of Nigerian music to be played on your station. So that's very important. Now that's very good as well. There's some stations now that are completely 100% Nigerian music. So it varies. It depends on the station music policy and format and the owners of the station. How did the songs get picked? Well, from my own experience or my own practice, I had a team of programmers. The programmers are there to research what is new. Now, because of Kanye West, we have New Music Friday. But before New Music Friday, we used to have music released on all kinds of days. So in a given week, you might have 100 to 200 songs, both Nigerian, both non-Nigerian. So you know what songs, whether it's hip-hop, whether it's R&B, what song, whether it's Nigerian, whether it's Afrobeat or Highlife, are going to be on your station. So you need to have people internally who are going to research, a research department that okay. will sift through all the releases for that particular week. And then you now have to decide within the station what suits your format, what is the best music that you can hear, what happens with that. Now, it's very hard globally for independent artists to get played on radio. The reason is because, I know I'm going to get a lot of flack for this. The reason is because the big boys have a certain quota of the airtime on radio stations, on TV stations. And I'm talking Warner, right. Sony, Universal. Right. So you're wondering why, and if you check, I mentioned those three names, but those three each own about 20 different record labels each. So you're talking about 60 of the most powerful wow. record labels around the world. So what do you think is going to happen when one of their artists releases a song? He or she is going to get automatic entrance to that playlist of that station.
Wow.
So which means that about 70 to 80% of a playlist of a station will be locked down for the big players. So really, as an independent guy, you're struggling with about that 25, 20%, 30% to get your song on. So, but don't despair, you still get it on. Now, Payola has been going on for before I was born. So it's some people call it marketing. I don't know what record labels call it marketing. It's a global thing. Kanye West releases an album. There's a marketing budget for it. That marketing budget could be $5 million. Beyonce could be $10 million marketing budget. The same way a movie like my sister here, she when she released her movies, she had a marketing budget. The marketing budget can be as much as 40% of the movie budget in some cases, so for a song. So I cannot speak on behalf of any radio station or TV station, but all I can tell you is that when I ran radio stations and I created the playlist and I created the formats, well, not created the format, but ran the playlist, I ran the playlist for two stations for 10 years each, more than 10 years each. I ran Cool FM's playlist for about 10 years. I ran BFM's playlist for about 11 years. We were based strictly on merit. And I have one of my programmers, ex-programmers over there. His name is Imran. And we used to spend 4 hours, 5 hours every Monday afternoon going through formats, so going through songs. So we, at least in our time, we did our best to give the small guys. The reason why I can say we created platforms to allow the non-big boys and big girls get heard. Because let me give you an example. When we first started Cool FM, a lot of the music that was being played was foreign. We made sure that we brought in local music. We blew a lot of local artists. And when we also brought music from around African continent as well. Then with Beat FM, what we did was we created a format that allowed the not so big guys. We had charts that where you had people like P Squared, the bands, all those big boys over there. But then we created charts where people like Praise, Simi, Adekunle Gold, Cobham's Asuko came through. So we had the Nigerian top 10, then we had alternative Nigerian top 10. So we gave
a lot of new artists the chance to be heard who ordinarily would not have been heard. So I can say I'm very proud of that legacy. Just one more thing, okay? If I add?
Okay,
sorry. I think I see a lot of nice faces and eager faces here. I want everybody to be encouraged to get into the creative industry. It's very important. When I first started, people were asking my dad, why is he doing this thing? He's not gonna make money. He's gonna end up smoking marijuana and getting drunk, you know? But I'm glad to see parents. Over the last 10 years, I get phone calls every week from parents seeking advice on how to get their children in the creative industry, and I'm very encouraged by that. Three things I'll give you. Number one, get started. Don't wait for anybody. Get your company registered, get an accountant, get a lawyer. If you don't have an accountant, if you don't have a lawyer, if you don't have a registered company, you have not started. Number two, plan. Get a business plan. Take a deep dive into the sector, whether it's film, television, music, fashion, technology. Take a deep dive and see what is going on in the landscape around you.
Okay.
It is very important. And the last one, collaboration. Don't be afraid to collaborate with people. Okay?
I think that's a good place to clap. That's a good place to clap. Okay, so as you can see, everyone, this has been an interesting discourse, and people seem to be learning a lot, and this is why we're here. We have just a very short time, as you can see, so, and I still have loads and loads of questions for everyone. So if you can kindly just like get to it, like very short and sweet, it'll be really nice. My next question is to Dako. So a lot of people use music, YouTube, for example, for music, different versions, and then they have their music, they have their videos taken down, demonetized or blocked. Everybody's laughing, so this is a general problem.
It's not me. Just to.
Okay, so basically, how do we deal with that? How do we deal with having our music, you know, our videos taken down? What are the guidelines? What are we missing? You know, why do we have our videos taken down at different times when we put it up?
I mean, that's fairly straightforward. So it's really about, so YouTube has guidelines that whenever you, especially when you sign into the YPP program or when you join YouTube and create a channel, you say, I read and accept. That's part of it.
We didn't read it. Sorry, it's not our fault.
We gave it to you. You said you are read and accept, and you know that's what it is. So we have specific guidelines because we have to. You know, YouTube is the biggest video platform in the world. We have a responsibility to you guys, so we have to make sure that it is a platform for everybody. Everybody can exist on that platform and can put up their content and can watch content safely. So we have guidelines that you have to go by. Now, if your content is taken down from YouTube, generally, if you go in your YouTube studio, which is your backend, you would see why it was taken down. YouTube would just generally tell you why it was taken down. If you think we are wrong for doing that, there's also a place to appeal that.
Right.
So you can always just appeal and make your case and say this. So many, I've seen so many instances, both when I was at YouTube and not before I joined YouTube, where, you know, a takedown was appealed and we put that back up. So it's a very fairly straightforward process.
Thank you. See, very short. Let's keep the energy. let's keep clapping now. What's going on? Thank you. It's good. So we talked about this earlier, Jade, when we were talking about the opportunities, when you talked about, you know, the collaboration with Chiki and all of that. So we have a lot of, all of us young cats, you know, in the industry who are thinking, what are the other opportunities? I'm young cat, so what do you mean? You know, what are the other opportunities and what are the other ways? So, of course, aside from maybe song selections, writing songs for the movie, you know, acting, you know, which is also another thing as well. So what are the other opportunities in the movie industry that actors, artists, producers, writers, and all of those people who are here, represented here, can take advantage of?
Does anybody know Lin-Manuel?
Lin-Manuel?
Yeah, so does anybody know Hamilton, the stage Broadway musical? So Lin-Manuel is one of the biggest sort of, right now anyways, music producers for film. So Eric at Moana, the recently done Little Mermaid, he sort of created all the music for that. He's worth about $18 million.
Wow.
Huge guy, right? People who write, produce music for film or write for film, it's a massive sort of business opportunity, I would say. So if you're already producing for musicians,
another way to, because it's your same skills, the same sort of equipment you're using, the same whatever.
Right.
If you can also look into film, that would be huge. Also because right now, Nollywood is in a renaissance sort of period where we're really growing. In fact, just recently, Disney did an animation with a Nigerian animation company, and they'd be looking for original music made by Nigerians. So if that's something you sort of carve a niche for yourself and you start to grow, that's a massive business opportunity, I would say.
Fantastic. Fantastic. So, David, very quickly, everybody, see, we have such a short time, and I have five more questions. So, how can we scale a talent? How can we scale a talent with funding, and how involved? I think you talked about this just earlier. How involved do you get in the managerial operations of an artist after the provisions of funds? So, do you get? So, is it a different arrangement with an independent artist, or is it different arrangement with an artist who has a record label? Jonathan, what does that look like? Very
quickly. Sound Holler does not deal with any management, marketing. We don't do anything. It's just money, right?
Wow.
Very simple. It's just money, right? If you need marketing, you have to find a distribution company for that.
You secure the bag. We don't care how you get it.
Yeah, exactly. Just help you get the money. It's very simple. That's all we do. We just help you with that.
Fantastic.
But we're into this too. What you just said right now about songwriting, right? You just started something because one of my staff actually, there's this rise of Afrobeats, especially in the US. I got a lot of urban people there, my connects. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, we need songwriters who can write Afrobeats for us.
Fantastic.
And so I connected him, and now they're about to close the deal.
Oh,
so
nice.
I figured, let's do this for a lot of people. So we launched it yesterday where you just need to write songs. It doesn't have to be fully recorded. And we just send it to them. If we close the deal, you get paid.
Okay. Fantastic. Thank you, every other person, for clapping. Mr. Lisa, this question is to you very quickly. As a music, because again, I know that you're a show producer, all of that. What are the issues, challenges, and frustrations that you've experienced with, the new cast? I keep saying this new cast thing, but for some interesting reason, that has stuck. But Mr. Alista, so what are the challenges, what are the frustrations that you've experienced with, the young, new artists in the industry right now? And then what would you say are areas that you want them to maybe pay attention to? I think you talked about something like that earlier in terms of collaboration, but in terms of these are the frustrations that you've experienced and these are ways that you can quickly work on that very quickly.
There's always new people coming through in any industry. Every year, there are millions of people in film, television, music. So my advice to you is, find your niche, decide what your skill sets are. Not everybody should be a singer, not everybody should be a rapper, not everybody should be a dancer. You can be a producer, you can be a choreographer, you can be a manager, you can be a video director. Find where you're good at and what you're good at and express that talent, but make sure you have everything done legally. A lot of sad stories about people, going on the journey. Secure yourself first, and don't be afraid to get on that journey. Don't be afraid to fail. I've been hearing a lot of people talking, a lot of artists talking about, I did it by myself. No, you're lying.
Yeah.
I paved the way. Are you working for Ministry of Works?
Self-made.
If you want to pave the way, go and work for Ministry of Works and house it. You didn't pave the way. If an artist in 2023 says, I paved the way for others, what would Lau Lekin say? Do you understand me? So find your niche, do what you do, but get involved and get serious about it. Get everything in order. Because I've seen some sad stories, I've heard stories of people getting on a journey, getting ripped off, or getting in the wrong direction, getting to contracts that are slavery contracts and whatnot. So get everything sorted out and get on that journey. Take that first step. It's very important. Everybody was new at one point. If any artist tells you that they have never played a show for free, give me their name. I'll tell them where and when they played that show. I know artists who got paid with yam and plantain and bags of rice.
That's impressive.
Yes. Okay. Everybody started somewhere. So don't be afraid to start.
Fantastic. Woo! So this has been very insightful. Even for me as well, because I'm learning a lot. I'm hearing some things for the first time, and this is really, really good. Now, I'm just going to go into Q&A now, because I believe that with all the, you know, all the insightful things that everyone has been listening to, we have questions. So if you have questions, there's a gentleman. Where? Gentleman, where? Where are you gentle? Okay, great. So there's a gentleman there who is waving the mic. How many? Last person. The lady in the Panama, fantastic. So let's start with the guy who's raised his hand first, in the middle.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you, McMusic. This has been very educative. I want to channel this question for more clarity to Mr. Olisa. It's regarding to PR rules in Nigeria. And I believe Performance Rights Organization in Nigeria is responsible for claiming performance royalty. And then we believe that performance royalty is a royalty we earn when our music is consumed in public places, like the radio stations and the TV station, for example. So, and there is a numerous misunderstanding that the, or currently maybe MCSN. Please, I want more clarity from you. Is it that the Performance Rights Organization don't get, I don't know, like, is it that the Performance Rights Organization of Nigeria don't collect this performance royalty from the TV stations, or is it that they collect it and for whatsoever? I just need more clarity. I don't know if it's...
Okay, sorry, before he takes your questions, right. For the other four people, please think about your question very quickly so that when it's time to ask, you can give me the question and then we can get to it, because we don't have so much time, if you know what I mean. So, Mr. Olisa,
all right, I'm just going to be quick. Are you a member of the unions? P-Man?
No, 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 I'm not.
Well, that's number one. Join P-Man. Are you registered with MCSN? They have an app called Go Create. Have you heard of it?
I've not heard from it.
Exactly. Bros, you know, when you enter a plane, eh? And they give you instructions in the plane. And they tell you, if there's any problems, put on your mask first. So help yourself first. You understand, before you help others. Register with P-Man, register with MCSN, okay? And then you go there and get what is due to you. There's money being collected by some of, I think COSON is proscribed, so COSON is not involved anymore. But I think MCSN is the sole body right now. So get involved with P-Man, which is the Professional Musicians Association of Nigeria, Musician Employees Association of Nigeria, and then also register with MCSN, which is the collecting agency that collects money on behalf of the rights owners, which are musicians, songwriters, producers. So get in there and get your money.
Thank you very much. Right.
Thank you. I have it. So what we're going to do is we'll take physical questions and then we'll take online questions, because I'm getting online questions here. So before, maybe hand over the microphone to the next person. You're the next person? So please hang over the microphone to him, but just hang on, I'll ask the online question and then we can do fiscal, right? This question is to David, and the question is, what happens in a case where there's a dispute on the music that was used to get a loan?
Dispute on the music. So, just to be clear, right, once again, it's streaming, right?
Yeah,
so
streaming.
You know, if you let's use DistroKid for instance, right, you could put, you can select, you know, you break the cuts down, the splits down, so we can see everything. This thing is cleared up. Like, we don't give you, like, you can even be signed to a label. We're looking for your percentage of the income. Does that make sense? So you can be making $10,000, but all you got was two. Your advance is on $2,000. It's not against $10,000.
So it's not the overall, I see.
Nope.
Okay.
Because we've had issues like that, and we're like, oh no, but you have an investor, right? And now you only have 20%, and you're like, I make all this money, sure, but you don't get all that money, mm-hmm. Right?
Fantastic. That was very, very good question. It's a good time to clap, you guys. No? All right. Yes. Please go ahead. Maybe just tell us your name. I don't think we got your name earlier. Maybe just tell us your name and then your question.
All right. Good morning, everybody. My name is. Afternoon, sorry, I came late.
Don't worry.
My name is Vitora River. I'm a singer songwriter. My question is for the movie
Daddy.
Music. So, when writing for movies, is there a platform or for, like, as a writer or a producer to get your songs to the filmmakers, or is just who you know, or whatever?
Very good question.
Fair enough. Good question, yes. Unfortunately, currently, I personally am not aware of any platforms that do that. It might be who you know, unfortunately. I do think that the music industry is a... Like, there's a network of people, and maybe getting into that network might be beneficial, because producers know other producers, they know that, and they're able to recommend people or songwriters based off of the work that you've done before and somebody else has heard of. So that's how the word of mouth sort of spreads. But currently, I wouldn't say that there's a particular platform that's where we go to scout talent. No.
Okay. I think this is more for YouTube. And the question really is, what are the requirements for a song to get to YouTube top 100 charts? I thought that was funny, but yeah.
I mean, Jaddy just answered it. People to listen to it, like we don't... No, YouTube doesn't manipulate the charts. Like, we don't have input in what goes to top 100. It's what the people want, so...
Right.
So essentially, get people to listen to your music.
And then you'll find his way somewhere on the charts.
Hopefully.
Somewhere on the charts, okay. All right, yes, the guy.
Okay. Good afternoon. My question is directed to the YouTube experts. Permit me to use that word. We are in the era where data is in abundance and people can easily gain access to it. And just yesterday, the president signed the data protection right. We all know that as much as we are interested in reading, people don't have time, especially in a place like Lagos. We're living the fast life. Is there a way that, you know, in order to simplify this rules and regulation, before we click on I agree, which we don't really agree on, is there a way we can simplify it? Maximum of 6 paragraphs.
3 lines, just 3 lines. I come for your house, your property.
I won't lie to you, as a person who is interested in reading, when I start to read, I don't finish. That is for someone who is interested to read what they're about to agree. Right? Is there a way it can be simplified?
They don't want you to read that thing.
To help us understand, because it's time consuming, and by the time you don't even understand. In all honesty, it sounds like jargons, because some terms are quite unclear.
Unfortunately, there's no way, because the thing is, with terms and conditions, those are the legal agreements. They're essentially binding contracts that are saying that this is what your rights are, this is what our rights are. You know, one of the things in those terms and conditions for us, for example, is that if you violate our community guidelines, then we have the right to take down the content. So unfortunately, you're gonna have to read it, right? It's a binding contract, so everything has to be spelled out, because you don't want a situation where something is ambiguous and then somebody is saying, but it was not in the... We want to address every possible situation that could come up, because again, we have that responsibility, not just to ourselves as a business, but more importantly to you guys as the users of the platform. So unfortunately, before you hit that,
You gotta
read it.
Fantastic. Man. So you have to read it, is what it's saying. But you guys don't design those things for us to read anyway. Like, if I'm being honest, it's not. Okay. So who has the next question? Who has microphone? All right. Okay.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, my question is for Mr. Ikumola.
Okay.
Okay, so. I don't understand why policy of the insurance company or something. That's why you see most of we youths, we don't really do insurance, because we don't even understand what you guys are about. My question is that, sir, properties can be insured, right?
Yeah.
We insure houses, we insure cars, even jewelries and everything. But sir, what about intellectual property? Our talent is a property, right? Our talent is a property. So that's why there is intellectual property.
So how do we
insure
that?
We insure that? Like, if an artist creates a song, can it be insured? A movie makers create a movie, can it be insured? Our talent, can it be insured?
Right, okay.
Yeah, thank you so much. Let me first say that that's a very good question and very insightful. Let me first say that insurance exists for the survival of other businesses. And the essence of insurance is to create values. And the research and development department of every financial solution provider is always on top of their game to look for more innovative products. I think I will take it home to see what we can do about that.
Okay, fantastic. Who has the microphone? Who has the microphone for the
next good morning,
question?
Everybody. My name is Eric Holter. Good morning, David. My question is for you. So I might be an antagonist here as to the 100 rule that you gave. As a presenter over time, I've gotten to interview quite a lot of up-and-coming artists. And let's be a realist. You said you need to get your family and your friends on your side first, okay? Music is a very jealous art. It's very it takes so much. In a case where, as an artist, you don't get your friends or even your family especially to say support you, give you the money to do your business and all of that, for those category of people who don't even have so much to be able to pump into their business, they don't have a record label, they don't have anything at all, how exactly does your company come in, or they're not your target audience at all?
So just to be clear, you're asking for a business or a product that does not have traction. How do we get them money to get that traction so SoundHolla can give them funding? Is that what you're saying? I'll say it again. You're asking for a product or a business that doesn't have traction.
Sorry, reconstruct that. Now, I'm not talking about your business per se. I just added that. So I said I'm going to be an antagonist to your 100 rule thing that you said. So I would like that you actually explain that and be more practical with everybody.
Okay, I'll make it clear again. Once again, that 100 rule works. Like, I mean, if anyone's in insurance knows it works. It works here. Once again, I'll say it again. Find 100 people. F&F, family and friends, does not mean your actual family and friends. It just means warm marketing, people you know. It could be people at work. It could be the guy down the street that you buy something from. It's marketing. Like, it's just somebody I know in my space that if I ask them for 5 minutes of their time, they'll probably give me that time. Find those 100 people. When you start talking to them, you need to find, if you're building any product, you need to find 100 people that love your product. Love, that means they are fans, super fans. Now, those people, your friends and family, people that are on their circle already are your potential target. If I post out my story, 100 people might see it. That's a 10,000 people reach if they do that. Pareto principle, 20% will convert. That's 2,000. Can I get 2,000 people that love me to stream my music 10 times in a month? Yes, I can. 20,000 streams. Can I release 2 singles? Can I do that every month? Yes, I can. It's 40,000 streams. You've qualified for SoundHolla's funding up to 8 times. That's $120. We can give you $9,600 over 2 years.
Okay. That's way, way, way clear. I think we have one more person, one more question, and then that's one more question. Where's the microphone? Okay, yes, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. Mine is a few comments.
Okay, sir.
First and foremost, I want to comment about this young lady who asked about how do you get your songs on films and all of that. I think the first step really is to look for a publisher. Publishers are the ones who take custody of your work, protect it for you, and the people who look for music for films get to the publishers to ask them for songs for the music. So the platform that she is talking about exists. That if you seek for the Publishers Association of Nigeria, I'm sure you'll find some information. And one of the things that I've noticed is that people don't seek information. Artists generally do not seek information. It's very important to seek information, and then you'll get a way out of what problems or solutions you're looking for. Now, the other thing is the young man who asked for insurance for intellectual property. There's a copyright commission. The copyright commission provides an umbrella for registering your work. Therefore, it can be protected. Insurance companies generally don't go provide insurance for, am I right, sir? You don't provide insurance for intellectual property. It's intangible. You cannot hold it in your hands. They protect those things that are like your cars, you know, your equipment, and all of that, properties that you can see and hold. But your intellectual properties, you can't hold it in your hands. It's in your brain, it's in your system, it's, you know, it's your intellect, it's your creativity. So that you need to look for copyright protection, get a lawyer, or go to the Copyright Protection Agency. Nigeria has a copyright commission. The register works. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much for your contribution. We'll just take one more question and we're done. One more question.
Okay, before, can I just add one thing to what my oga just said?
Yes.
Microphone. Along with the publishing, sync companies, the companies that exist right now, you can find them online. They license, you license your song to them and they can shop for you to get your song on films, okay, TV shows, radio, TV commercials, whatnot. So think about that as well. Fantastic. But you can find it online, okay?
Okay, who has the microphone? And that's the last question for the day. Who has the microphone?
Good afternoon, Uncle Lisa. My name is Tunde Thani. I want to ask you a very personal question. It is dear to me. There is this company, the company is called Group Hate. I don't know if you're familiar with it, Group Hate. See, the CEO is Tajudeen Adepetu. The major reason why I came here is because a few weeks ago I received an email to come for an interview there. Now, I started off making shoes when I left the university, and because to support my, you know, my actual dream, which is to, you know, be a full-time recording artist. So it was not until 2021 that I delved into music full-time, and I've been having challenges, you know, supporting my heart financially, like going all out financially to actually, you know, apply myself like I would love to. And I think a few months back, I may have applied for a position there at the office. Probably I saw it on LinkedIn or probably on Instagram, because even the show, I found it on Instagram.
The question is,
for an individual, that for an A student, basically, that is in a community where it is difficult to raise money without going left, how do one actually really mix the idea of generating revenue with from a 9-to-5? Now, I wanted to channel this question to you, basically, because I feel like if you had probably made music while you were doing everything you were doing in showbiz, maybe you'd understand. Like, is it easy? Is it logical? Does it make sense? Like, is it possible?
I'm confused.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay.
What's the question?
The question is, how do one actually live the dream, the actual dream, and trying to keep a 9-to-5? Is it because, like, as an intern I worked at GT Bank. When I left the university, the reason why I didn't go back to the bank to do a full-time job was because I wanted to become a recording artist full-time. So growing up, I have actually woken up to the realization that, like, I need finances.
Okay, let me hold you there. We don't have too much time. You are talking about being an entrepreneur.
Exactly.
Not entrepreneur.
Yes.
Maintain your day job. Uh-huh. Your passion, your real dream job, passion, work at it as a side hustle.
Yeah.
You can. There are people doing. There are millions of people doing it every day in Nigeria. So maintain your daytime job, whatever it is, that puts food on the table, clothes on your back, and a roof over your head. Work on your hustle on your own time and push it hard. My dad told me, if you dream on an empty stomach, all you dream about is food.
Absolutely.
Exactly. So it's visible, right?
So work on both. You want to become an intrapreneur,
okay,
not an entrepreneur. You maintain your 9-to-5,
okay,
but you have your side hustle, your right, passion work. Until that becomes monetarily satisfactory,
okay,
hold on to what you have, right, okay?
Yeah.
All right. Mama.
That's all the question.
That's just all the one question. More thing, lady, the movie lady.
That's all the questions that we can take.
Can we have your email address, please?
My name is Jade.
Can we have your email
Don't
address?
Worry. Yeah. She will provide a contact information for us to reach everyone. Please go ahead.
I'd ask, please come forward. It has to be short and very to the point. If you go left, I'm going to take the microphone. Very short.
Greetings, everyone. I am General Pio. My first question goes to the YouTube representative. Like you said earlier, you said when they use your song on YouTube, you get paid for it. How about when a neutral person uploads your video on his YouTube page? Do you get paid for it as well?
So yes and no. It depends on what... So when you upload a song on YouTube, right, when you release a song, either just YouTube or you upload a song on YouTube, upload a video, there's something that YouTube tags that song with. It's called Content ID. Now, every song has a unique Content ID. Every song in this world that is on YouTube has a very unique Content ID. When your Content ID shows up somewhere else on YouTube, typically when you upload your song, you tell YouTube what you want to happen if your Content ID shows up somewhere else. So you can say, let the person keep the video up, but whatever is made on that Content ID comes to you. So you make the money from that. That answers your first question. Now, you can also do it in a way where if that song goes up, you instruct YouTube when that song goes up that if you see this Content ID somewhere else, take it down immediately. That's what a lot of the majors do. So the majors that Olisa was talking about, that's what a lot of them do. Now, the third option is that you give somebody, whoever it is, so somebody can come to you and say, hey, I want to put your song on my channel, blah, 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 blah. You can do something called whitelisting, which is you allow just them to put your song up. But again, whatever agreement you have with them is what stays. But like I said, your Content ID belongs to you. When you get your Content ID, if what you've told YouTube to do is to take it down, immediately that song goes up, it comes down.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
So we've come to the end of this very insightful panel session. What we're going to do is just take one final remark from everyone, very quick, very straight to the point, less than a minute if we possibly can. And I'll start with Dapo. Quick closing.
Thanks everyone for being here. We have a YouTube workshop that's going to happen right immediately after. So if you have any questions for me,
exactly.
Any more questions for YouTube, we're going to do a deep dive. If you have any more questions about YouTube, how YouTube works, the workshop is called Understanding YouTube. So we're going to be talking about everything from how you optimize your presence on YouTube to what's available, our features and all of that. I'll be happy to answer those questions. Thank you guys for coming. It was great to speak to you and lovely to be here.
So we'll just do this in the same order. Jadi next.
Okay. Thanks for coming. Like Uncle Lisa said earlier, start now. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. You will make mistakes. I made many mistakes. But you will recover from those mistakes, right? And what I would say, the final thing is do it because you love it, because there will be many obstacles on the way. If you don't love it, you'll give up. So do it because you love it, the money will come.
David.
Thank you everyone for being here. The Sound Holler team is there if you ever want to speak to us. I actually advise every artist here to go on the platform and actually put your name, because at any point you qualify, we will reach out. The AI automatically sends you an email telling you get funding from us. Right, that's that. And, you know, start with why, know your who, and just find how, and then you get what you want.
Amazing. Amazing. The next
one. Thank you so much. Like I said earlier, I was super excited being in your midst. My advice is for you to make a hay while the sun shine. Take a decision now. I'll be waiting for you over there. Thank you.
Amazing. And then so we go to Uncle Lisa.
I think I mentioned earlier, just get started.
Absolutely.
Embrace technology. Do not be afraid of what is new. Okay, if a dinosaur like myself can become tech savvy, you can do it. And don't be afraid to fail. Make sure you get started. Make sure you get involved. And it's very, very important that you know where you are going. All right? And multiple revenue streams. I live by that every single day. You need multiple revenue streams. Don't put all your eggs in one basket, okay? It's very important, because there's nothing sweet as an alert coming to your phone,
yep,
of something you've forgotten about,
yeah,
that is making you money. The richest people in the world make money when they are sleeping. Think about that. Multiple revenue streams. Get involved and get started. And good luck.
I'm sure you agree with me that this has been insightful. This has been a lot to take in, and I can see everybody taking a deep breath. Like, you know, you're making room for all this information to settle in. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. This is the first panel session for today, and I hope that it was worth your time being here. If you do not follow Make Music Lagos online, Make Music Lagos, Make Music Abuja, Make Music Nigeria, please do follow Make Music right now. You can do that on your phone while you're here so that all these informations, you can have access to it. If you guys don't mind, you can please come forward. Let's take pictures together.
This is Make Music Lagos. Can you feel the beat? Every sound from every heart, it's time to let it breathe. Raise your voice, we're singing. Lift up a sound you're feeling. Let the rhythm from your heart be felt in every tune. Let the band play now. Every heart, it's time to let it out. Raise the voice, we're singing. The number sound you're feeling. Let the rhythm from your heart be felt in every tune. Let the band play now. Guide around, lift up the sound from your heart to let it out, let it out, yeah. Put your hands like this, come on, everybody's head.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for sitting.